I grew up in the country on a dairy, and I have a lot of siblings, amazing dad. My parents got divorced when I was 9 years old. I was a daddy's girl, so I was okay with the fact that we stayed with my dad. My Oma became a big part of my life at that time. She took us to church every Sunday, prayed every night before we went to bed. We would catch spiders and burn them, and spiders squeal when they burn. And we would catch grasshoppers and put them in the freezer. And we used to put salt on snails too, on slugs. We were horrible kids. I had a cousin named Dana who kind of led the charge on tormenting bugs. I mean, he was my first kiss. He was my first love. He was my first everything. We always had a lot of fun. We'd always hang out in groups of friends, and he just was always so, whenever we were together, he was always so taking care of me and wanting to meet and just wanting me to be having a good time. And I always felt like I was the most important thing, no matter how many people were around us. But he could so easily hurt me just as fast. I just was consumed with him. I wanted to be with him all the time. And we were friends for a long time, not for a long time, for a little while before we started to date. And my family didn't approve of it because he wasn't a good guy. He had just gotten out of jail when I met him. And he just was everything to me. So it was really hard when my dad told me I had to make a decision. It was either date him or move out. And I moved out. He was very controlling. He was angry, very jealous. Jealous that my family might have more control than he did. I think he was also fearful of me leaving. I didn't have an opinion on anything. I just really didn't care what happened. I let him take the lead on everything, and we still fought all the time, violently. We had broken up, and he was out gallivanting like he always did, and I was at a friend's house, and I stayed the night there, and in the middle of the night, he showed up, knocked on the window, wanted to talk to me, and so, like always, I went with him, and we went back to his house, and he was so sure that I had cheated on him, he just kept hitting me. And every time I told him no, he would backhand me. And it went on for hours. And finally, when the sun was coming up in the morning, and my mom was calling, and she said, "If you don't let me talk to my daughter, I'm calling the police." And finally, he let me leave. And the police came. I put him in jail. And I had never been so scared in my life. I really didn't know if I was going to get out of that night. I just prayed. I just prayed that the night would end, that God would take me out of there. He had been up for so many days on methamphetamines that his eyes were completely black. It was all pupil. There was no color. And it was hard because it was like no matter what I said, he didn't see me. I was determined I was done. I had his name on my ankle covered up. I really thought I was free, because how could I be with somebody who could do that to me? He spent like 30 days in jail. and was out and started leaving flowers under my windowsill. Started calling me constantly. All it ever took was one phone call. As soon as I got on the phone, it was done. It was right back. I picked him up from jail. We went straight to Las Vegas. I lied to all of my family and promised them I was not going to get married, and knew exactly we were going there to get married. And then shortly after we were married, I started doing methamphetamines. Once I started doing it, all of a sudden it was like I was not trustworthy anymore. And he lost a lot of faith, I guess, in me. I spent so much time with my little sister. We were literally our best friends. And right away, she knew. And it was more of an embarrassment to be around my family. So then I alienated myself. It just wasn't the way things happened in my family. You just don't do drugs. So there was a breaking point with his parents where they were just done. They were done taking care of us. They were done watching us kill ourselves. They knew we were doing drugs. He was even very honest with them and said, "I've been up for days. Please just let me sleep." And they told us to get out, and this time was different because they made us pack our bags. It wasn't just leave, it was get your stuff and leave. And at that moment, we didn't know what we were going to do because we always had them. And my sister actually let us sleep on her living room floor for the night. The next day, we thought we were going to go back. He was going to talk to his parents and we'd be back home, but it wasn't. We didn't know what we were going to do. And my mom, who very much disliked him, said, "You can come stay with us, but no drugs." And I don't know what changed, but that was the last day I ever did drugs. It was that moment. I just would rather have my family, and I was done. And me and him went to my mom's. Sorry. So me and him went to my mom's house, and we're clean for the first time in a very long time. Everything was going really good, and he relapsed. So he had called me, and he didn't know what to do. I came up with this brilliant idea that we were going to trade the meth that he had left for some marijuana so we could get him to go to bed. And that's exactly what we did. And he went to sleep, and we've both been clean for 13 years. We run into a friend who was a real good friend. Back when we first had got together, and she was asking how we're doing, how's everything going? kind of just telling us about how their life had progressed. You know, they had gotten married, they had a baby. It was a little hard to hear that we had missed out on some good stuff. But then she said, "Hey, you guys ever think about going to church?" We started some really good friendships back that helped walk us through some really hard times. A lot of change started to happen. He would raise his hand almost every Sunday, and they were praying for him, and it was powerful. And then on Easter in 2006, we had decided to get baptized. If he didn't have God in his life, I think there'd always be something missing. There would always be that peace that wouldn't completely fill us and bring us back to where we were. So they're getting ready to go to men's camp. Before he had left, he was still doing drugs. Yeah, he still was a jerk. He still was controlling. He didn't want to go. He said it was a cult. All this Jesus thing was nonsense. And really, he just wanted to spend time with his friends. And he didn't want to quit smoking weed. He didn't want to hear everything that he was supposed to be doing. He still wanted to do what he was doing. He wanted to be that cool guy. After camp, he came home and quit smoking weed. He started to care less about what people thought about him and just wanted to be a good person. He wanted to walk a better life, and Jesus was helping him do that. It changed us because it started to heal something inside myself. It was just letting me be a person, have an opinion. I had a job. I finally felt good about myself. I wasn't relying all on him. I was strong. I was stronger than I ever thought I could be. It brought a closeness to us that was never there. It almost like we were safe to say what we felt. It just was a new way to be together. It was a different experience. And it was awesome because we got to experience it together. And I already knew about Jesus. I grew up with Jesus. I loved praying. Praying is still one of my favorite things to do. And I was taught very young how important the power of prayer is. But now it was something we got experienced together. And it was an amazing feeling. My name is Susan Howe. I've been married for 17 years. We've been together for 22, and we are forgiven.